The following is a VSC-TV special presentation.
Hello, welcome to Studio B in the Fine Arts Building at Valdosta State College. I'm Alec Wainer, the coordinating producer for an exciting new program that premieres tonight. Let's meet the executive producers, Dr. John Manasco and Robert Nulph.
Thank you, Alec. The VSC Journal is new and original programming. It is done by very talented students, and we're really proud to have this opportunity to showcase their work.
What classes do these students come from?
They comprise four different telecommunication classes. And in those classes, they have to produce, shoot, edit, direct, and perform sundry other duties that relate to the program itself.
Well, can we expect to see more original programming like this in the future?
Well, this first show is just the first installment of the VSC Journal, and we hope that if all goes well, to see many more installments coming in the future. This show, as John has said, is written, directed, and produced by the students, and we will see more of their work here at VSC.
Well, with that, let's go on with the show.
Tonight on VSC Journal, a behind-the-scenes look at the VSC drama production of The Murder of Roger Ackroyd. What goes on before the curtain goes up? And Janice Stump looks into the pros and cons of sunbathing. Are sunseekers fashionable or foolish? Eileen Griffin takes us to Moody Air Force Base for a visit by the Air Force Thunderbirds. These and other stories tonight on VSC Journal.
Welcome to Studio B for our first installment of the VSC Journal. I'm your host, Kelly Stryker.
And I'm Mike Touchton. We have several interesting stories for you from VSC and Valdosta at large. We'll be coming to you at different times during the year with different segments written, produced, and directed by VSC students.
Well, that's right, Mike. And we have some great shows lined up for the weeks ahead. Most of us have experienced some type of stage production, whether it be a Broadway show or a local little theater company. But how often do we get to see what goes into the finished product? Our first story is a behind-the-scenes look at VSC's recent drama production of The Murder of Roger Ackroyd.
A lot of work, sweat, and time goes into the staging of theatrical productions, so much so that the finished product will be so smooth to the audience as to appear almost effortless. Tonight, we will look at the many challenges of staging a major dramatic production in the theaters of Valdosta State College. The classic mystery novel, The Murder of Roger Ackroyd, is the basis for the stage adaptation by Mrs. Beth McRae, the director, and Guy Clyatt. The setting is the town of Kings Abbott, Virginia, for this cat-and-mouse game played out by the great Belgian detective Hercule Poirot and a collection of highly suspicious characters. Audience members will be able to try to figure out with Poirot who committed the murder of Roger Ackroyd.
Yes. Mr. Ackroyd spoke of him so often.
You know,
nice to see you.
Poor Roger, you look absolutely lovely.
Look.
Dr. Shepard, you know Shepard?
Who is your first
lecturer? I know.
Chris Wood is stage manager for the play. He must make sure the production runs smoothly from rehearsal till closing night.
As stage manager, it's my job to make sure that all the actors are here on time when they're supposed to be. I also like to take them through about a 15-minute warm-up to prepare them psychologically and physically for what's going to go on that night, whether it be running a scene, running a complete act, just running lines. Several different things could happen. So they have a meeting at about noon, somewhere around there, with the director, Beth McRae, so that we can work out any problems that we might have had the night before and try to get them solved the next night. Also, I have to be in charge of making sure my actors know if there's any schedule changes. Having never done this before, I never really respected what a stage manager was, and I always, just kind of shoved them off like, oh, there's nothing to that job. But when you're in these shoes, it changes your whole perspective. You can understand why the stage manager said things that he said, why he did things a certain way, and why there is a stage manager around.
Probably 5 or 6.
Robert Nix has the challenge of two roles. First, he is the technical director for the show's set construction. Secondly, he plays the major character, Dr. Shepherd.
2 minutes after 9. I was upset and worried. I'm going to leave the jacket on, right? This one, okay.
As the technical director and being an actor in the show, it's turned out to be both advantageous, more advantageous than disadvantageous. It's really nice to know how far along your set's coming and where things are going to be, because I had an edge on other actors knowing that I was going to have a wall here, a door here, my fireplace before these things went up. So it helped me a lot in blocking. But Dr. Shepherd comes along fairly well. I do the technical work during the day mostly, and then at night I come in and become Dr. Shepherd and take over. And he is the middle-aged doctor. He's in his 50s and knows what's going on, knows his business here, and a quick-witted guy. He's right on Perot. Perot's about one step ahead of him most of the time. And so he's right up there on the level with him. And Dr. Shepherd's coming along. He's a really nice gentleman. Gets along with the audience well, and gets along with his other actors and other characters on the stage. He knows what's going on. He plays right behind Perot in the investigation, and assists him in a lot of ways. Writes down all the information, and seems to be really caught up in it. He finds the whole thing quite intriguing. He's really interested in it. And his sister Caroline brings him quite a bit of information here and there. So he pieces the puzzles together along with Perot, but to Perot alone. Credit for solving the mystery.
James says you believe someone in the house committed the murder. All I can say is you're wrong.
And mademoiselle, I should not like to be wrong.
I've got the facts pretty clearly. As far as I can see, of all the people in the house, only two could have had the chance to do it. Ralph Patton and Flora Ackroyd.
Caroline? That's...
Now, James, don't interrupt me. I know what I'm talking about. Parker saw Flora outside the study. She could have done it then and there.
Caroline?
I'm not saying she did, James. I'm just saying she could have. As a matter of fact, I don't think she could kill a chicken. And say what you will, but I just don't believe that Ralph Patton is a murderer. A boy we've known all our lives.
Yes, he has a weak nature, but hardly a vicious one.
Let us take a man. A very ordinary man. With no thought of murder in his heart. There is in him, however, a strain of weakness, which so far has not been called into play. Perhaps it never will, and he will go down to his grave, an honored and respected man. But let us suppose that something occurs. He stumbles onto a secret, a light. Now I appeal to the rest of you. If you know where our family is,
the challenge, as far as I'm concerned, is not working with the student cast. The challenge is on the part of the student cast, working with a relatively novice actor, you see. And the thing, personally, which is a challenge to me, is to absorb and to deal with the complexities of this craft. And one might first, in thinking of the Perot character, think of one Agatha Christie. One thing I'd like to mention about this is that this is a unique and original adaptation of The Murder of Roger Ackroyd by Beth McCrae, which makes this extremely special. But when one thinks of his character, one might think of the accent. In point of fact, that has become, for me, the very easiest thing. I happen to have started my career as a French teacher, so that sort of took care of that. But in fact, as this production has progressed, that has become a very interesting compromise in that when I might know very well that a person who spoke French originally in transferring to the English language would say a word a certain way, it's evident to me and also to the director, I might add, that the audience wouldn't really comprehend the word actually said the way it might be said. It's an interesting compromise between what perhaps should be and what an audience would recognize and immediately pick up without having to stumble over and thus find troublesome in pursuing the storyline of the play.
Mesdames et messieurs, I will continue. I mean to arrive at the truth. In all probability, this will be the last case which I shall ever investigate. And Hercule Poirot does not end in a failure. I need to know. And I shall know, in spite of all of you, I shall know.
What do you mean, in spite of all of us?
Just that, Mr. Diamond. Each one of you in this room is concealing something from me. It may be something unimportant, trivial, supposed to have no bearing on this case. But there it is. Each one of you is hiding something from me. Am I right? Voila, and now I have my answer. Now, I appeal to you all. Tell me the truth, I will have it. The whole truth. Will no one speak?
Well, Kelly, did I tell you that the stage manager of that show, Chris Wood, I went to school with him at Lowndes High.
No, you didn't, but did you get to see the show?
Yes, I did. You know, the run of that show was very successful.
And by the way, Mike, we did find out who the murderer was.
But let's not spoil the surprise. We'll be right back.
We're VSC students, working to bring you better local programming in the area of sports, arts, and information. Thanks for joining us. We're VSC-TV.
Welcome back to VSC Journal. The middle portion of our show is a segment of short takes from VSC campus around Valdosta and the surrounding areas.
Terry Woods brings us a revealing profile of Modesta McGinn, a student in the internship program here at Communication Arts.
Sent us a delightful young lady this year, Modesta McGinn, who has worked for the Majority Leader's Office and the Rules Committee, and she's just done a super job. And we don't want to lose her. We hate to see her go back, and we might try to keep her permanently. She's just been super, and if she's indicative of the Valdosta State students, I say send her some more next year.
Hi, this is Terry Woods, and with me in the studio today, Modesta McGinn. Modesta was the intern for Larry Walker, who happens to be the majority leader. Modesta, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me, Terry.
First and foremost, Modesta, what were your duties as this intern?
I dealt with the media, constituency problems, problems that the people had with certain bills that were going through the House, and I also was the assistant to the Rules Committee Chairman, Bill Lee.
So do you see any future with Larry Walker in politics?
Possibly. Right now, I think I'm just going to take it one step at a time.
Well, Modesta, I wish you the best in the future, and once again, thank you for being with us today.
And it's nice being here. Thank you, Terry.
You know, Kelly, that was quite interesting. That did strike close to home with you, though. Didn't you do something like that about a summer ago?
Well, as a matter of fact, Mike, I did, but I know this next segment is in your interest.
Well, that's quite right. There's nothing quite like going to an Air Force show as a child, seeing the jets roaring overhead, the different planes on display, and let's not forget the cotton candy and hot dogs. Eileen Griffin takes us to Moody Air Force Base for an exciting look at the Air Force Thunderbirds.
As part of Community Appreciation Day on April 16th, Moody opened its gates to the public for a glimpse of the Thunderbirds at their finest. The Thunderbirds dazzled and delighted thousands of spectators at Moody Air Force Base with their feats of aerobatic precision. We interviewed Major Dave Robinson, who flies as the slot pilot in the Diamond Formation, and asked him what are the qualifications for becoming a Thunderbird.
We do have several qualifications, one of which is you have to have less than 10 years of commissioned service as an Air Force officer. to be in a position of a demonstration pilot. Also, you have to have more than 1,000 hours in a high-performance aircraft before you can apply for the team.
Okay, and as far as other jobs, is this your only job, or do you do other type of things while you're not flying?
We have other jobs within the squadron, but our sole job as a member of the Thunderbird team is demonstrating the aircraft around the world.
Okay, how many pilots are there in the Thunderbird? What does the crew consist of?
We do have 8 pilots on the team, 6 of which you'll see fly in the demonstration. The team consists of 11 officers and about 150 enlisted people.
Okay, and how much discipline is involved in this? Because I see that you do a lot of things right on the dot, very precise and everything. How is the discipline?
Discipline is critical to what we do. If you take that many airplanes and fly in formations low to the ground, discipline is paramount. It's very important in all flying, but even especially in the demonstration role, it's key to what we do.
Okay, and I'm curious as to why you wanted to become a Thunderbird. What instigated you to want to do this?
Well, I grew up around airplanes. My father was in the aerospace industry all the time I was growing up. About the age of 10, I was first exposed to a Thunderbird show. And at that time, the dream of flying, I guess, started. And as I worked through my career as a pilot, it finally and met the qualifications, I decided to apply.
Okay, how does it feel to be up there? What goes through your mind when you're up there?
Well, I love to fly. In the air show, it's a very business-like environment, however. We know we have a job to do. We're out there to put on the best show we can. It's a lot of work. It's very challenging, but I do enjoy it.
Okay, well, how does the communication go out there? Who says what needs to be done, and what are the type of cues that you get?
Most of the times during the air show, you'll notice there's 6 airplanes airborne. However, 4 are in a formation together, and we call that the diamond formation. And the 2 solo pilots are separated. Most of the air-to-air communication that goes on is between the leader and the 2 solo pilots, and also the leader to the airplanes that are with him in the diamond formation, letting us know what maneuver he's going to do and various ways that he's performing the airplane at the time, so we can stay in tight formation with him.
And up to this date, what has been your most memorable experience? What comes up to mind when you think of, you know, something great?
Last year, we spent 35 days in the Far East, in places like Australia, Hawaii, and some real hardship places like that. And we also did a show in Beijing, China, which is the first time the U.S. fighters have been in that part of the country since World War II, and the first time ever the Thunderbirds have performed in a communist country, and that was a very interesting experience.
I bet that was great. Well, I want to thank you very much for sharing this with us, and I wish you lots of luck. Thank you. This is Eileen Griffin at Moody Air Force Base for VSC-TV. Thank you.
That was quite interesting, Kelly. Have you ever seen an air show before?
I have one time before, and it was really fun. I enjoyed it.
Where did you see yours at?
Down in Lake City, Florida.
That's quite nice. The one they had here at Moody Air Force Base, I just stepped out of the backyard and turned my head up and watched them fly around. You know, a lot of people don't realize, though, that it takes and requires a lot of physical and mental fitness to become an Air Force pilot.
That's right, Mike. The fitness craze has gone from fad to a way of life. And many organizations provide fitness facilities for their employees. Well, VSC is no exception. Jimmy Brookins gives us a look at what's happening at the VSC Physical Education Complex.
Well, the physical fitness is constantly changing. Here at VSC, professors are taking great steps to keep up with those changes.
Dr. Tom Jackson has a plan that will convert these classrooms into a new state-of-the-art wellness laboratory.
We're hoping by the fall of 89 to have a new curriculum in health promotion and wellness. In the meantime, we can make some provisions for students interested in that in pursuing that curriculum with what we have in existence. To support that curriculum, that major for the health promotion and wellness person, we needed a laboratory where they can train, and we're going to establish what we're going to call the wellness laboratory for the better a better terminology for what most people would refer to as a fitness center.
What a plus a facility of such innovativeness would be for VSC, but there's still a question of where will the money come from.
Through the Dean's Office of the School of Education and via the Vice President and the President, they're giving us the seed money to start this program off.
Jimmy Brookins, VSC-TV.
Originating from the Department of Communication Arts at Valdosta State College, we're VSC-TV, bringing you a wide variety of sports, arts, and information about your community. Stay tuned for more entertainment on VSC-TV.
Welcome back. With a new emphasis on health and fitness, fashion-conscious people want to look healthy too, and these days that means having a beautiful tan.
But experts tell us that ultraviolet rays can be harmful to our skin and eyes. Are sun seekers fashionable or foolish? Janice Dump looks into the pros and cons of the tanning trend.
This time each year, thousands of people flock to the beaches and poolside to bask in the sun and work on their tans. We spoke with several students at Valdosta State College and asked them why they find sunbathing such an attractive pastime.
You get a better tan, and because it looks good in clothes. Tans look good in clothes.
Okay. How about you? Why do you sunbathe?
I don't know. Just wasting my time, I guess.
I sunbathe because I think a tan helps a person look healthier. That's the main reason.
Oh, because I like to get a tan and it makes you look better in clothes. And then whenever I go to the beach, I don't like to burn. I like to get a beach tan.
We spoke with Dr. Kenneth Wirtz, an oncologist in Valdosta, and asked him about the effects of tanning on the skin.
The sun has a cumulative effect on the skin. Prolonged exposure to the sun causes more damage to the skin, premature aging, possible pre-malignant or pre-cancerous lesions or cancerous lesions, malignant skin changes. The skin, after being prolonged with exposure to the sun, will have a senile appearance, or it loses its collagen texture, becomes more rough appearing, and has areas of thinning and areas of thickening in the skin.
Can someone die from a skin cancer?
Well, not as a rule. Most patients come to the doctor for care for a skin cancer. Usually they begin as a small area on the skin, and the only person I'd say that would die from a skin cancer is one that neglects it and lets it just overcome their body.
For those that choose to sunbathe, are there any preventive steps that they can take to avoid this?
Yes. There are sunscreens recommended for the skin. People can wear dark clothes. When they're sunbathing, they should avoid, which would be hard to do, areas where there are a lot of reflections, glossy coated materials, metallic sheens, the white beach sands are also enhance the radiation effects of the sun.
What types of sunscreens do you recommend?
Okay. There are three types of sunscreens, and that depends on the wavelength of the light that you're being exposed to. The shorter wavelengths, the recommendation for a shorter wavelength of light that causes the sunburn and the tanning effect, you should use the commercial products known as pre-sun or blockout, and then the other sunscreens in the next two groups would be the ones that block the full spectrum of light. And they are known as, they have a higher protective value, like pre-sun 15 and total eclipse. And the full spectrum plus visible light protective effect are the ones that come in a cream-like application, and they block all spectra of light and have more protection. But there's disadvantages to those also. And the ones that block the shorter wavelength of sunlight tend to, they adhere or they're more substantive to the skin. So that's an advantage. But the higher protection or protective value of the sunscreens, those creams tend to come off easily when you sweat or when you go into the water. So reapplication of sunscreens are necessary.
We asked the students how they felt about using sunscreens.
Worried about it right now. I'm 19 years old and I got a long way to go. I'm not worried about it.
Not at all.
Any sunscreen?
Occasionally I use oil or lotion.
But no sunscreen?
No sunscreen.
Baby oil and iodine.
What is she?
Crisco, anything. Anything to bake the skin.
We interviewed Mr. Lewis Griffin, who, through the years, has had numerous skin cancers removed due to sun exposure.
Yes, I've had about five, and in the last 20 years, I've probably had 10 removed. Mm-hmm.
And what did the doctors say was the cause of these skin cancers?
They said that most of it was caused from tropical sun, because I had been in Puerto Rico for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And that now that my skin was so bad that I would have to keep it covered up to keep from having more of them.
Mm-hmm. Had you used any kind of sunscreen or any protection during the previous years?
Yes, I've used some, but for many years I didn't use it.
Mm-hmm.
And they say now that I have to have the skin a solution that takes the old skin off and puts the new back on,
mm-hmm.
To keep from it continuing to be that way.
Mm-hmm. And you have to dress these every day?
Yes, it's a special dressing that goes on it, called, I believe, Durotherm or something of that nature, that they say that you don't put anything but peroxide on it,
mm-hmm.
and clean it.
Mm-hmm.
You do not use any other solution other than,
mm-hmm.
the dressing, that your special,
mm-hmm.
dressing that you put on it.
Does it seem to be helping them?
Yes, it seems to be closing up. It,
mm-hmm.
was bigger than it was. It's been done a week.
Mm-hmm. Did they say it was going to take a while, though?
Said it would take 3 weeks,
mm-hmm.
at least for that one to
mm-hmm.
to clear up.
Mm-hmm. So will you be using sunscreen now and long sleeves?
Yes,
and
long sleeves, sunscreen, and hat. And the highest, I understand they make a 35 sunscreen now. I'm going to get some of that,
mm-hmm.
and use that. I have to use that every time I get out in the sun.
Mm-hmm. Would you recommend to the young people and teenagers to start now taking precautions in the sun?
Yes, I would, because the sun is, and it's a known fact that the sun does cause skin cancers, and if people don't use the protection, as they get older, their skin will develop more skin cancers than they are. I wouldn't recommend it without sunscreen. Anybody being out in the sun very much, especially the hot sun.
Mr. Griffin, thank you very much. I'm Janet Stump, and this is VSC-TV in Valdosta.
Well, Kelly, I see that you're the type of person that likes to stay out in the sun. After seeing that, are you going to use a more intense sunscreen?
I think, well, after watching that segment that Janet Stump did, I think I'll use a more intense sunscreen. How about you?
Well, yes, I believe I will. I have a bad tendency to burn, so if I'm going to go out in the sun and lay out, I'll probably use one of the higher strengths, like maybe a 17 or a 25.
That sounds good to me. Well, that does it for the first edition of our show. We hope you've enjoyed it.
Look for us in coming weeks as we bring you more and exciting editions of VSC Journal. I'm Mike Touchton.
And I'm Kelly Stryker.
Good night.
Thank you.
This has been a VSC-TV presentation.